Well, hello. Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. We're so thankful that you're joining us for another weekend of online ministry. We want you to feel welcomed and included in all that we are doing as a church. My name is Heath Hatmaker, and I am just so excited to see you here. I want you to make sure that you feel welcome, and I want to welcome first-time guests that are joining us and just say that we are glad that you're here, no matter if you've joined in every week or this is your first time. We're so thankful that you're joining us for today's service, and I'm really excited about today's service. We're continuing our Road to Reality series, and Pastor Jeff Thompson from our Chicago Cathedral campus is going to be preaching today, and I am just really excited to open God's Word to the book of Romans. We've been making these pit stops, and Jeff is excited to bring the message today, and I'm really excited for you to join in with us, and so that's coming. We've got a fantastic worship set that is scheduled, and really quickly, before we get into the service, I've been told that this week is Thanksgiving. I don't know, 2020 has just done this thing where you don't really know what day it is or what month it is even, but we're here, it's Thanksgiving, and my wife Colleen's family does this thing every year where they go around the table and everyone gets to say what they're thankful for. And I just wanted to do that right now in the comments. So go ahead, think about it, type it in your chat and put it in the chat. We would love to just see those things. And I know 2020 has been a year that maybe it's harder to think of something to be thankful for, but man, the Lord has been so good to us. And despite any circumstances externally, the Lord has met with us in this place. And the fact that you are joining us online is one of the things, one of the gifts that we have received this year. And so let us know in the chat what you're thankful for. I am thankful for you. I'm thankful that we are online right now and that we are able to worship the Lord together. And so put that in the chat, prepare your heart for worship just to reflect on what the Lord has done, the things that he has given to you. And we're gonna worship the Lord right now. So wherever you're at home, in the car, in your bed even, prepare your heart now for worship as we go into the worship center.
Hey, Harvest, come on, let's stand to our feet wherever you're at this morning to prepare our hearts to worship our God.
We make way for you, prepare a place for you. Let our praise become your throne. Your people sing, we give you everything, Jesus, all for you alone.
All right.
And all hail the King, all hail the Savior, Jesus, the Son of God. And all hail his name, all hail his power. As we crown him, Lord, our Lord, Lord of all. This is royalty, robed in majesty, and all the earth will stand in awe. And for eternity,
man, it's so good to worship together. My name is Heath Hatmaker, and I just want to welcome you to the service. If you just joined us in the last few minutes here, I want to especially welcome anyone who's watching for the first time. We love first-time guests at Harvest, and I think it'd be so cool if you were comfortable and willing to just let us know in the chat that this is your first time that you're watching. I know that our people that are watching and our staff that are watching would love to welcome you as well. And we would also love the chance to connect with you, and that's why every single week we check in at our church. And that looks like letting us know that you're here, letting us know how we could pray for you, and letting us know if there's any information that we could give to you that would be helpful. And so if you're watching on our website, you can go ahead and check in right now. And if you're watching on another platform, you can download the app and check in there. Another thing that we do every week that I wanted to initiate right now is our giving. And so you're seeing on your screen right now that there are four ways to give, some of them electronically, and then obviously we would love to receive a check mailed into our campus if that's what's best for you. And we believe that God is worthy of everything that we could give to Him. Every good thing that you and I have is a gift from the Lord, and so we want to give with abundance back to the Lord. And so we do that financially every week, and we also want to do that with our time and with our talents, with the things that the Lord has given us. And it for sure is a different season right now in our church, but there are still a ton of opportunities for you to join in and for you to come alongside our staff and our volunteers, our people, as we continue the work of ministry. And so at harvestnow.info, there is a space where you can let us know and you can see ways that you can serve. And we would love for anybody and everybody to be a part of the work that we are doing at our church, all for the glory of the Lord and for His name's sake. And so if you're interested in that, harvestnow.info is a good spot for you to let us know that that's the case. And harvestnow.info is another fantastic spot for you to be connected in community. We love small groups at Harvest. We say it all the time that we are not a church with small groups, but we are a church of small groups. And if you're not connected right now, if you're not in a small group, join in with brothers and sisters that are following the Lord, can I just charge you, compel you, challenge you to join a small group? I promise that it will be a blessing in your walk with the Lord as we link arms together and as we pursue what the Lord has for us. And so I just wanted to invite you, if you're not in a small group, harvestnow.info is a space where you can let us know and someone from our team will reach out this week and they'll make sure that you're in a small group. And we want to continue to worship the Lord even right now as we're gonna head back into the worship center. And so would you pray with me and we'll go now. Lord, we love you. We love worshiping you. We love hearing from your word. And so we invite your spirit again right now to join us as we continue in our service. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let the King thank you.
so good, Jesus. Thank you for all you've done. Oh my God, thou fairest, greatest, first of all objects, my heart admires, adores, loves you. For my little vessel is as full as it can be, and I would pour out all that fullness before you in ceaseless flow. When I think upon and converse with you, 10,000 delightful thoughts spring up. 10,000 sources of pleasure are unsealed. 10,000 refreshing joys spread over my heart, crowding into every moment of happiness. I bless you for the soul you have created, for adorning it, sanctifying it, though it is fixed in barren soil, for the body you have given me, for preserving its strength and vigor, for providing senses to enjoy delights, for the ease and freedom of my limbs, for hands, eyes, ears that do your bidding, for your royal bounty, providing my daily support, for a full table and overflowing cup, for appetite, taste, sweetness, for social joys of relatives and friends, for ability to serve others, for a heart that feels sorrow and necessities, for a mind to care for my fellow men, for opportunities of spreading happiness around, for loved ones in the joys of heaven, for my own expectation of seeing thee clearly. I love you above the powers of language to express, for what you are to your creatures. Increase my love, O God, through time and eternity. Amen.
His holy name. We sing your praise, we sing your praise, we sing your praise forever. We lift your name, lift your name, Jesus.
Exalted over all, to you alone all praise belongs. Christ exalted over all. Yes, Lord, that's our prayer. To you alone we give the glory. To you alone we give the highest praise, for no one else is deserving. Christ exalted over everything. You're on the throne. You're in charge. Your kingdom won't be shaken. And so we rest in that. We worship in light of that. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Hey, church family, it is so good to be together, to worship the Lord, to lean into his word, and to meet with him today. And we're so glad that you're joining us. You know, sometimes we come to church to hear a difficult message from God's word. And sometimes we come to church to be instructed how we're to live a holy life, to have some tools in our toolbox to go out this week. And sometimes we come to church to be stirred up to go and to serve him and to impact the world in a greater way for Jesus Christ. And sometimes we come to church to be encouraged by what he has already done and what he is doing in us. Family, today is a day of encouragement. So if you feel like I have felt, you need this message of encouragement for us. We need God's message of encouragement from his word. We need God's message of freedom that's found in the Spirit. We're going to be in Romans 8 today, so go ahead and grab a hold of your Bible wherever you are and turn to that right now. But the interesting thing about this passage is there are no imperatives. There's no commands. There's nothing that we're even told we have to do about it. But there's so much that we can be encouraged by. And it's my prayer that you will leave the service today encouraged, and you will leave with a greater grasp on the reality of the Holy Spirit and how He's worked in your life and how He is working in your life. That we wouldn't just say, I know these things, but that we would be thrilled by these things. That we would let them sink down deep. We would move beyond any element of spiritual numbness into a greater relishing of what the Spirit has done on our behalf. So let's pray about that right now. Father, we are grateful for your perfect word. We're grateful that you have given us this word at this exact time. And Lord, we pray that you would speak through your word to us, encourage us, help us to be rooted and grounded in the faith that we have in Jesus Christ and in the work of the Holy Spirit on our behalf. Would you work in us for your good purposes today? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, last week we learned that we are in Christ dead to sin, that we're no longer a slave to sin. And today, in Romans 8, we're going to see the reality of the Spirit for me. The Spirit is mentioned 19 times in chapter 8 of Romans. Paul has only mentioned the Spirit 4 times before this in the entire book, but here, 19 times. So we are seeing a central reality of the Spirit on our behalf. Romans 8, beginning in verse 1, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their mind on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their mind on the things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile toward God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God." We see from Paul that there is a clear distinction between those who are in the flesh and those who are in the Spirit, those who have faith in Jesus Christ and those who don't. And if you are in Christ, the Holy Spirit works in us and works for us to accomplish what we cannot now and for all of eternity. The Spirit gives me freedom. Paul begins by saying, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those of us who are found in Jesus Christ." He's pointing back to all of these benchmarks, all of these road markers that we have seen on this road to reality. All of the things that he has mentioned already in the book of Romans. He's made it crystal clear to us that we are sinners, that we are in need of God's grace, and he gives that grace freely to us in Jesus Christ. We've been justified, we've been set free and declared righteous because of what Jesus has done. Nothing can change our standing in Jesus Christ because of all that he's done for us. We've been set free from sin, that we're no longer bound, we're not a slave to it any longer, and while we still sin, and while we still have the effects of sin in our life, you and I aren't free from it completely, but we have been set free so that we're no longer slaves. And so while it's not possible for us to go on without sinning, we do have God's power at work in us that makes it possible for us not to sin. You have that choice. You and I will both fail often. We will both fall short continually, maybe daily. But we can choose because we are no longer slaves to sin. But Paul is beginning here by telling us that even when we do sin, even when we look back on the ways that we failed in the past, and even when we look at the things right in front of me that I'm failing in right now, we're not condemned in those things. Condemnation, as he talks about here, is not just the guilt, the fact that I am guilty before the Lord. It's also the punishment that comes because of my guilt. And in addition to that, it's the shame and the guilt that I feel as a result of my sin. And Paul is saying, you're free from the guilt. You're no longer guilty because you've been justified. And you're free from any punishment that you might receive because Jesus paid for it already. Loved one, that's amazing news to us. Especially if you're like me, I am so sick of myself. I'm so sick of my sin and sick of the ways that it hurts the Lord and causes this rift between he and I. Sick of the ways that it has impacted in a negative way those who are around me. But the incredible reality is that we have freedom in the Spirit because of Jesus' death for us. We often punish ourselves. Maybe we make ourselves feel like we have to pay for the sin that Jesus has already paid for. One of the ways we do this is we feel like, you know, maybe if I do enough good, maybe if I create a chart with gold stars to show, to just track my progress because I want to be really good. I'm going to make sure I read the Bible and I'm going to pray and I'm not going to say that beep word and I'm not going to be mean. I'm going to be kind. And what we end up doing is we feel like, you know, Monday was a great day and look at all the gold stars that I got. I really had a great relationship with the Lord that day. I had his approval that day. And Tuesday was, you know, it was okay. I was falling a little short. But then as the week goes on, we begin to feel more and more like we just, I don't know, I just didn't do it, and so I don't feel God's approval. But the reality is, there is no way that you can please God with any amount of gold stars. We all fall short of God's perfect law. So maybe we try to do good enough, and I'm just going to try to make sure my good outweighs my bad, but that won't earn his approval. Or maybe, like me, some of you feel like, if I feel a great guilt for my sin, if I feel incredible remorse and brokenness over the way that I've sinned against the Lord, if I feel really sorry for it, maybe if I beat myself up enough, or I remind myself often enough that I am a total failure, if I do all of those things, maybe I'll begin to feel like I've really paid for my sin. When in reality, it has been paid for already. You have no condemnation because you're in Jesus Christ. You don't need to hold on to any of that. You have been set free. You know, Johnny and Susie were visiting Grandma and Grandpa's farm, and Johnny had just gotten a brand new slingshot. And Johnny's out in the back, and he's, you know, firing at a tin can and misses by a mile. And he fires at the broadside of a barn and misses that too. And just over and over, all of these rocks just keeps missing. And as he runs into the house for dinner, one last shot, he shoots a rock, and he hits Grandma's pet duck and kills it. And so Johnny is freaking out. What am I going to do? So he takes the duck and he hides it behind the woodpile, thinking, you know, maybe Grandma will think it ran away or something else happened to it. So Johnny's running in then to get to dinner. And right at the door of the house, Susie meets him. And she says, Johnny, I saw what you did to Grandma's duck. And if you're not good, I'm going to tell her what happened. Yee. So they go in, they have dinner. Right after dinner, Grandma says, you know, Susie, I really need some help with the dishes. Could you come into the kitchen? And Grandpa says to Johnny, well, while they do the dishes, why don't we finish this jigsaw puzzle I've been working on? And Susie says, no, Grandma, actually, Johnny said he wanted to do the dishes and then I could help with the jigsaw puzzle. And she leans over to Johnny and says, remember the duck. And Johnny goes, yep, I would love to help. I can dry, I can wash, whatever you need. I'm happy to do that. The next morning, they get up, and Grandma says to Susie, you know, Susie, I really need your help in the garden today. I've got to pull some weeds. We're going to plant some flowers. And Grandpa says, well, Johnny, why don't we go fishing while they do all of that? And Susie says, no, Grandma, actually, Johnny said he would love to pull all of the weeds in your garden today and that I could go with Grandpa. She leans over to Johnny and says, remember the duck. And Johnny's like, yep, I'm ready to pull weeds. Well, this goes on for some time, and Johnny says to himself, you know, I don't know what Grandma's going to do to me when she finds out that I've killed her duck, but it can't be as bad as what Susie's doing to me. So he goes in and he tells Grandma, you know, Grandma, I'm so sorry. It was an accident, but I was out in my slingshot, and I shot your duck, and I killed your duck, and I'm so sorry. And Grandma picks Johnny up and brings him over to the window and says, Johnny, I was standing right here. I saw the whole thing happen out the window, and I forgave you in an instant. I was just wondering how long you were going to let your sister terrorize you like that. And some of you are walking around listening to those voices that would say, remember the duck. That voice in the back of your mind that comes up often saying, remember the duck. The voice of the enemy that echoes through your ears saying, remember that thing that you did. Remember the way that you acted. Remember the way that you sinned against the Lord. Remember the way that you hurt that brother or sister. Remember that thing that you did. And we have these voices continue to go through our lives that say, remember the duck. Listen, don't go on living your life like you have to pay for your sins. It has already been paid for, and you are free from all condemnation. We have seen this so often in the book of Romans that we're no longer a slave to sin. You don't have to carry it with you. You don't have to remember the duck. It has been forgiven, and there is no condemnation for you. There is nothing that can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. There is no condemnation for us. No amount of guilt can overcome it. No circumstance can block it. No massive disaster can destroy it. Nothing, nothing you do, nothing others can do, can bring an ounce of condemnation against you in Jesus Christ. Isaiah 54, 17, no weapon that is fashioned against you shall succeed. You shall refute every tongue that rises against you in judgment. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and this is their vindication from me, declares the Lord. This is who we are because of the Spirit's work in us. He has set us free from condemnation. So stop listening to the person telling you to remember the duck, because Jesus has paid for it. And there is no condemnation that's found in him. Complete and total forgiveness, full acceptance into his love. That's what we have in Jesus Christ. That's what the Spirit accomplishes in your heart and in mine because of what he's done. And he not only sets us free from condemnation, it says he sets us free from the law of sin and death, from the enslaving principles of sin and of the flesh, of their binding power over us. And Paul here, when he talks about flesh, he's talking about all of our natural inclinations, the drives that each one of us have, the ways of thinking that each one of us have because of our sinful nature. You know, we never fully get control of these things, and naturally, our sinful nature leads us to resist God. It leads us to be away from him, not drawn close to him. Listen, this is why it is a terrible piece of advice to tell someone to follow their heart. It makes for a really good Disney movie, but it's a terrible piece of advice. It's a terrible piece of advice to tell someone to do what they want to do. You shouldn't do what you want to do. You should do what God's word tells you to do, because in here we're promised life. So don't give that advice. Our flesh will always lead us away from the Lord. We all have the flesh, but what Paul is telling us here is only those who don't know Jesus Christ are still in the flesh, because Jesus was our sin offering and paid for all of that, and by his death he's condemned sin. And although we still have the flesh and daily we must replace it with the Spirit, it's been condemned in us. It has no power. Where we should stand in condemnation because of our flesh, our sin has been condemned and we have been made free. God condemned sin in the flesh so that we would have righteous lives. It says so that the requirement of the law, the righteous requirement of the law, would be fulfilled in us. So there's no longer a need to walk around feeling like I have to do the right thing or say the right thing or think the right thing in order to be right with God, because the requirement of the law has been met for me. And so instead, I walk around living God's purposes because I just desire to show him my love and my gratitude for everything that he's done in me. Because I know that I'm not worth any of that, and yet he's placed his love upon me, and he's given me his freedom. And so that's the thing that propels my life. That's the thing that changes me and makes me more into the image of Jesus Christ. For 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, "For our sake, he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God." Jesus became what we are so that we could become what he is. He became a victim of sin and death so that you could be righteous. That's what's happened in Jesus Christ. It's not done by our acts of obedience. It's not done by our gold stars on the checklist. It's done by a union with Jesus Christ. And all believers have this union. In this passage, Paul is talking about Christians who are walking in the Spirit and those who are not. He's not talking about that. He's not talking about how we're putting on the Spirit. There's other passages of Scripture that talk about that. But here, Paul is specifically talking about Christians and non-Christians, those who have the Spirit and those who do not. And all believers have the Spirit. There's a contrast here between those who know Christ and those who don't. And there's a difference of mindset, of values, of standards, of goals. And listen, none of that is because of us. None of that is a reason to boast. It's been given to us by the Holy Spirit. But it is a reality for us to understand. And he also says that there's a transforming of our mind that's taking place because the Spirit is in us. Through salvation in Jesus Christ, our mind is set on the Spirit. So that as we walk by the Spirit, as we cooperate with him in greater ways, we're continually transformed into the image of Jesus Christ. So our natural wants, our natural desires, our sinful nature begins to fall away. And it's replaced with his wants, with his desire, with his nature in us. Now remember from a few weeks ago, we were enemies of God. We were hostile to God. It's not even just that we didn't want to submit to God. We were unable, and all of our efforts would fall short. See, Paul's not talking about like levels in biblical Christianity or anything like that. There's either the mind set on the flesh or there's the mind set on the Spirit. There isn't an in-between. Jesus would say, you're either for me or you're against me. And so we're not on the fence on this. He's telling us that you're in the Spirit or you're in the flesh, and those are the only two options. There's such a contrast here with those who are in the flesh and in the Spirit, and those who are in the flesh experience death, and those who are in the Spirit experience life. They gain God's approval because of what Jesus has done for us. You cannot do anything on your own to gain that approval when you're in the flesh. But only the Spirit gives life and peace. Now, an important thing to notice in this passage is death can refer to a few different things. And especially in the original language, death meant several things. For us, most of the time when we say death, we're talking about physical death. But we see in Scripture often that sometimes it can mean physical death, that a person actually dies. Sometimes it can mean spiritual death, that there's an eternal separation from God. And then sometimes in Scripture, it can also mean this concept of moral corruption or moral frustration. It's the being torn apart in my soul because of what's happening. We actually use this in slang a little bit in English sometimes. When something's really bad, we might say, oh man, I just died. Now, we don't mean physical death happened there, and we don't mean spiritual death. What we mean is that we were just torn apart by what happened. And so Paul uses the word death in two different ways in this passage. First, here in verse 6 and following, he is talking about spiritual death. Those who have trusted in Jesus Christ and received the Holy Spirit will not experience spiritual death. We will experience his eternal life in us. And those who have the flesh, who are in the flesh, will experience spiritual, eternal separation from God. They will experience this death. But for those of us who are in Christ, the Spirit gives me life. Verses 9 through 11 say, "You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. If anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you." When we were apart from God, we were controlled by the flesh, and now we're controlled by the Spirit. He says, if in fact, it's actually a statement of certainty, like without a doubt, you're in him. Now, I don't have to tell you that our physical bodies are dying every day. Every day we move a little bit closer to death, and I know that's the encouragement you came to church to hear. Our mortal bodies are dying each day. We're feeling the strain of age, the pain of a health condition that just isn't getting better, the thing in your body that the doctors can't even figure out what's wrong with you. Or maybe it's just those aches and pains that seem to increase day by day. But the Spirit is life because Christ is in us. Even though our physical body is on its way out, the Spirit is dwelling in us and working in us, and we have eternal life in Jesus Christ. So we're still bound to a decaying body, and we're still surrounded by pain and hurt and sin, but the Spirit dwells in us, and every believer has the Spirit residing in them, bringing eternal life. And it says here that it's the same Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead. That same Spirit dwells in you and works in you. The power that raised Jesus from the dead is working in your life today to produce eternal life. God is working through his Spirit in you. And if you are in Christ, you will be raised up with Jesus on that last day. It says Christ in you. We've been joined to Christ. There's this union that happens. It's much like the marriage union that we learn about in Ephesians 5:30 and following, that the two become one flesh. And in God's eyes, there is no separation there. But the beautiful reality is not just that we are in Christ, as was mentioned in verse 2. You are in Christ. You've been justified. You've been saved. You've been cleansed and purchased because of what Jesus has done for you, and that is a beautiful reality. But it's not all. Not only are you in Christ, but the text here says that Christ is in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Because far too often we understand the gift of salvation that's given to us, but not the person of Jesus Christ with us. You see, there's not just a receiving of salvation. There's actually a receiving of the person of Jesus. It's intimacy with him. Jesus isn't like Santa. He's not distributing gifts and then hopping on a sleigh to go take gifts to somebody else. You see, when we receive the gifts without receiving the giver, we miss what it means to really be in Christ. We have Christ for us, but not Christ in us. You aren't just receiving the gift, you are receiving the giver. You aren't just saved and forgiven, he is living his life through you. Some of our campuses are doing this really cool ministry. It's called Operation Christmas Child. And the way that it works, if you've never done it, is you get this shoebox, and you take the shoebox to Target or wherever, and you fill it up with, you know, personal items, toothbrushes and things like that. You get some fun toys, just some fun things for a child. Maybe you write a little note and sign it, a Bible verse or something like that. And then this box gets shipped across the world to a child who is not going to receive a Christmas present. It's really a cool thing. You get the privilege of giving a gift to somebody who will receive it with incredible joy. But that's very, very different than the loving parent who takes the time to get to know their child and then goes out shopping and finds the perfect gift for their child. A gift that not only says, I know you'll love this, but a gift that says, I love you. See, far too often we receive the shoebox like a child who's grateful for the gift but has no idea who the giver is. Loved ones, we receive the giver of salvation. His incredible gift draws us into a relationship with him so that we're not only saved by him and in him, I am with him and he is with me. And that radically changes our reality. The Spirit gives me life. Life in Christ, Christ in me for eternal life. And the Spirit gives me abundant life. Let's look at Romans 8, 12, and 13. So then, brothers, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. He begins, notice he says, brothers. It actually is better translated brothers and sisters in the original language, but he's talking to believers. That's why he uses that term. He's coming back here to just talk about believers. He's been talking about this contrast already, and now he's hammering down like, but listen, it's not like that for you. It's like this. He's coming back to cap off this section about the Spirit's work in us. Now remember, as we saw in verse 6, Paul talked about death there to talk about eternal death, to talk about separation from God. But here in verse 13, Paul can't be using this term death to talk about spiritual death because he's talking to believers, and we are clearly told from God's word that you will not have eternal death. You won't have spiritual death because of what Jesus has done. And he can't be talking about physical death because both believers and non-believers, we all experience physical death, unfortunately. And so clearly he's using this third usage that we talked about before, this idea of moral corruption. So by death, he's talking about the fact that we reap the consequences of sin, that we reap the consequences of evil and of suffering, the heartache that is felt from our sin and the heartache that's felt by the way that we handle incorrectly the sin of others, the way that we respond in unhealthy ways. That's the death that he's talking about. He's saying if we as believers choose to live according to the flesh, even though we've been freed from it, then we will experience this kind of moral corruption. You can't lose your salvation. You're not going to lose your eternal life, but you won't experience abundant life in the measure that you could. All believers, to the degree that we live under the flesh, we're going to have moral frustration. Galatians 5, 16 and 17 says, but I say to you, this is Paul again, but I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things that you want to do. So while still saved, we're not experiencing the abundant life that's offered to us in the Spirit. And I don't have to tell you right now that people are stressed. People who know Jesus are stressed. People who don't know Jesus are stressed. There is a whole lot of stress in our society right now. But apart from a life in the Spirit, there's nothing good in the flesh. No real way to handle that stress. No true hope or love or joy or peace. Oh, they can have it in small increments and placed in the wrong things, but not as we have by the Spirit and through Jesus Christ. I've heard so many people who don't know Jesus talk recently about their gratitude that this season of COVID won't last forever. That, oh man, the vaccine's coming soon. We're going to be done. I have hope that this will end. What if it doesn't ever end? Now, don't stone me or anything like that. Don't send emails to the church. I believe it will end. I believe that it isn't going to last forever. But listen, we're not promised that. That is not a promise that we can be assured of. We aren't promised that our trials will end. We aren't promised that our loved ones will all be healed. We aren't promised financial security. We aren't promised a life without hardship. We aren't promised that we won't experience the pain. But we are promised the presence of the Holy Spirit in our life. We are promised abundant life. What he means by life here is this living in God's wisdom, in obedience to him. It's all that makes life truly worth living. The love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control, these things that you can only have in fullness through the Holy Spirit. We can't accomplish these on our own, and the world can't accomplish them at all. Only the Spirit working in us can accomplish these things to its fullest. That's the abundant life that we're promised. And those who don't know Jesus will never have it as full as we can. Not because of anything about us, but because the Spirit brings that about. But many of us would ask, like, well, how come I don't always experience that? What if I don't feel like I'm experiencing the abundant life? Because if you've been walking with the Lord for any amount of time at all, there are seasons where you don't feel like you're experiencing the abundant life. And for many of us, there are extended seasons where we don't feel like we're experiencing the abundant life. And I don't want this to come across as flat. I would never want to just throw a Bible verse at you and say, just trust the Lord, you have the abundant life, get on with it, you know. It's not that. So if I am not experiencing, if I'm not feeling the abundant life right now, what's going on? I want to give you a couple things about that. It could be because you have unknown or unrepentant sin in your life. It could be that you have sin in your life that you have yet to turn over to the Lord. You have yet to confess these things to the Lord. And when we do that, it doesn't change your eternal salvation. Do not forget in all of this that there is no condemnation for those of us who are in Christ Jesus. But our sin patterns, our unhealthy and unrepentant sin, can cause a barrier for the Spirit's full work in our life. You're not losing the Spirit. He will continue to work. But there's ways that we quiet the Spirit's work in our lives. So if this is you, ask the Lord. Take some time and ask the Lord to search your heart, to reveal to you any sin. Quickly confess those things and then believe that you have received forgiveness because what he's already done, because there's no condemnation in Jesus Christ. So repent if need be. Now it could be because you are lacking faith. Now this passage again doesn't say anything about what we need to do, just what we need to know and what we need to really know. So let these things sink down deep, to know them at your core, to know it more than what you see, to know it more than your circumstances, to know it more than your feelings, to know these things and to be thrilled by them. I grew up playing hockey. I'm sure you can tell by my massive physique here, but one of the things that my coach would often yell at us is that we needed to pass the puck more. And I can remember so many times hopping back on the bench after a shift and the coach yelling at us, pass the puck. And we, you know, as teenagers, we would always respond, I know. And every time he would say the same line to us, he would say, no, you don't know, because if you knew, you'd pass the puck. You see, the knowledge isn't just I know that I'm supposed to pass the puck. It's that I really, it sinks down so that it really affects me and changes me. And maybe you know these things. Maybe you know all of them. And you could, yeah, I've read these verses so many times, but you haven't really known them. You haven't let them sink in. And if that's you, here's what I want you to do this week. I want you to take a little bit of time and to meditate on this passage. And I want to get real specific for you. I want you to take 15 minutes. You got Thanksgiving week. You got plenty of time. Take 15 minutes. Get alone. Get your Bible open to this passage. Read this passage out loud. And then get on your knees. I don't mean, you know, metaphorically, like physically get on your knees if you are able, and pray out loud, God, help me to really get this. God, would you reveal yourself to me? Show me the ways that I'm not really seeing this or grasping this, and help me do that, Lord. So it could be because of sin. It could be because of lacking faith. It could be because that's why you come to church, right? To get the crystal clear explanation of why these things happen. And I so wish that I could tell you why. I so wish that I could go to a chapter and verse and say, this is exactly why you're not experiencing it. But I don't know. Maybe the Lord is using that so that you depend on him. He's using that absence of feeling like he's working so that you would depend on him. Maybe he's preparing you for something greater. Maybe he's actually keeping you from something unhealthy. Maybe he's teaching you to act and to depend on him even when you don't feel like it. But what I can tell you is when we look at God's word, the people who we see as the best, as God's best, have experienced extended dark nights of the soul. Noah spent over 40 years building the ark in preparation for the flood. Think of the long days with splinters in his hands while not hearing another word from the Lord. What are you doing through this, God? And Abraham waited 25 years to see God's promise of a single dependent. Think of the long years that he and Sarah were waiting, every year going by, looking into their aging faces and feeling the fact that, physically speaking, this is not happening. And not hearing from the Lord through all of that and crying out, when, God, when will this waiting be over? Joseph waited for 22 years to see his dreams come true. Think of all of the years in slavery that he spent, the darkness overshadowing him, in the dark nights in that prison, the feeling of his soul as he wrestled with the pain and rejection of his family, the pain over all of the injustice done to him and the sin on him. Why, God, why has this happened to me? Moses spent 40 years in the wilderness, away from his people, away from his family, raised as royalty, now on the run. Think of the hurt and the distance, the despairing conversations, crying out to the Lord, where are you in this, God? For years before he ever went to a burning bush and heard the Lord's voice. David was anointed king of Israel. And you know what he did next? He went back to being with the sheep. In the darkness, in the silence, in the loneliness. It was 15 years before he would be king. All of that being overlooked, and then years running for his life from Saul as he hunted him down. Where are you, God? Why don't I see this changed? You see, we expect something different, but God has a proven track record for his people here. God does his best work in us in the dark. In the place where you most feel the absence of the Spirit working, I believe he's most at work there. Because he's not in the rushing wind. Because he's not in the lightning and the thunder. He's in the still, small whisper. God is in the silence. And he's doing his best work in you during that silence. Loved ones, this passage begins and ends with freedom. What God wants us to see from his word today is that there's nothing you can do to please God, and there's nothing you need to do to please God because it's been done for you in Jesus Christ. The Spirit is in you and working in you for his purposes. Whatever weight you're carrying today, whatever confusion you feel or hurt you're feeling because of circumstances or because of your own sin or because of your shortcomings or because of what has been done to you, you have freedom in Jesus Christ. And it's all been covered. Whether or not you're feeling his abundant life right now, you have it. Believe that you have it because of Jesus Christ. Because you've been set free, you've been set there secure. The Spirit is in you and the Spirit is for you. Because it's not dependent on your sin or your circumstances or your feelings. It's solely dependent on his perfect work in us. The Spirit gives you freedom. The Spirit gives you life. The Spirit gives you abundant life. The Holy Spirit works in us and works for us to accomplish what we cannot. Now and for all of eternity. And we have, here at Harvest, we have a conviction about God's word. We want to be doers of the word, not hearers only. And I'm a doer. I like to, you know, what's the next step? What am I supposed to do? But it's so clear from this passage that it's not about that for us. It's not about what we're supposed to do because the doing is done. And it wasn't done by me, thankfully. Why is it so hard for us to receive what's been freely given without any action on our own? Why, when I'm invited over to someone's house for dinner, the first thing I ask is, well, what can I bring? Or, you know, we'll have you guys over next time. Or, man, I should write them a thank you note. This feeling that I have to do something or have to provide something for what has been given to me. And believe me, because I'm a doer, I want to give you exactly what to do this week. I want to say, here are the three things to do this week. But more than that, we are faithful to God's word, and we have to be faithful to it. And he doesn't go there. It's far less about what you need to do to experience abundant life, and far more about what we need to know. So yes, meditate on the passage, pray through it. Lord, soften our hearts, illumine this text. Help me to really get this, because how is that not a prayer that God will answer? Help me get past my spiritual numbness to really get this, but I'm not going to give you a long list of things to do because I can't begin to fill in the blanks of how he can meet with you with perfect clarity this week. Because the Spirit's worked in each of us, I believe that he will continue to work in us and bring that perfect clarity. And what if the Lord just wants us to slow down, to cease striving, and to trust him in greater ways, whether we feel like it or not? You know, in his timing, we're in this passage this week, this Thanksgiving week. A Thanksgiving that we haven't experienced before, when most of us have canceled travel plans, most of us aren't getting together in big groups, and I suspect if it's like me, there'll be a lot more quiet this week than most Thanksgivings. And that's a blessing from the Lord. Maybe he wants us to slow down and to contemplate this thing, these things. And so the worship team is going to come and they're going to sing this song over us. And as they do, let's take some time to meditate on what he has for us today. You can feel free to stand where you are, to join in singing if you like as you learn the song. But let's not miss for the chance for the Spirit to speak to us with absolute clarity today. If you've never experienced this life, this week could be your week where you turn from your sins and embrace Jesus Christ and experience that freedom and the Spirit working in you. If you've experienced this, but not in a while, or I've experienced it, but not in an ongoing way, ask the Spirit to reveal to you this week. Ask him for wisdom. So often we want to look to other people to tell us what to do and to reveal to us only the things that the Spirit can. So we pray that He would reveal this deeper reality of His presence in our lives. Father, would You work in us for Your good purposes? We thank You for Your word. We pray that Your Spirit would draw us to You. God, illumine this text in greater ways so that we can trust You, so that we can love You, so that we can follow You. God, we desperately want to experience Your abundant life in increasing ways. We give all this to You in the name of Jesus. Amen.
For we know the truth, Your truth has set us free. In Your name alone, we have been released. You are here with us. You are here with us. We are slaves no more. Freedom is our own. Never looking back, Jesus, You are Lord. We give all to You. We give all to You. With the Spirit of the Lord, there is freedom. When the Spirit of the Lord changes, eyes are open, Christ is with us. Christ is with us. Who the Son is freed, He has freed indeed. And all our sin is gone. We have been redeemed.
Yes, we have.
And Jesus paid it all. Oh, Jesus paid it all. With the Spirit of the Lord, there is freedom. With the Spirit of the Lord, change. Eyes are open, Christ is with us. Christ is with us. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, chains are broken, eyes are open. Christ is with us. Christ is with us.
He is with us. Christ is with us.
Open wide the gates of heaven. Fill our hearts as we surrender. Lord, let Your presence fall. Lord, let Your presence fall. Open wide the gates of heaven. We will worship You forever. Lord, let Your presence fall. Lord, let Your presence fall. It's open wide the gates of heaven. Fill our hearts as we surrender. Lord, let Your presence fall. Lord, let Your presence fall. Open wide the gates of heaven. We will worship You forever. Lord, let Your presence fall. Well, so grateful for that message from Pastor Jeff. We hope that you have an amazing Thanksgiving week, and we'll see you next week. You are loved.